Dr. Kondalrao sir wanted me to talk on ischemia trial. So we all of you know this is not published yet, so there is no peer-reviewed publication as yet. So this is only a study which has been presented in ACC last year in November. So I'll just briefly go through the basic trials of stable CAD and what does ischemia signify for all of us. So just I'll go through with a single case, and let us take a typical example of a case which was a 58 year old male, class 2 angina, diabetic patient. ECG and echo are normal. We do a CT angiogram because of his symptoms, which shows a middle AD 70% stenosis, mid RC of 80% stenosis. So what do most of us do? What are we supposed to do? So that's what we would discuss. So management of this patient, can we try GDMT, guideline directed medical treatment first? Should we go ahead and do a PCA first? Are we giving any prognostic benefit by doing a PCA for this patient? And if we have to intervene, when should we intervene? So what do the guidelines say actually? So the ESC guidelines tell us in a stable, we are basically talking about stable ischemic heart disease. So we are not talking about ACS patient, unstable angina patient, or a patient with LV dysfunction. We're talking about a stable ischemic heart disease patient. So let's not forget that. So this is, we need to intervene only in case of two conditions. One is for the prognostic benefit. Second is for symptom relief. For prognostic benefit, general class one indications would be a left main disease, which is significant, proximal LAD disease, which is significant, multivessel disease with significant LV dysfunction. Again, if there's large area of ischemia which is detected, or if the patient has got a single coronary artery which is stenosed. Again, for symptomatic benefit, ideally we are supposed to do a GDMT or good medical treatment. And patient remains symptomatic, then you should go ahead and do stenting for this patient or intervene in this patient. That's what the guidelines tell us. So this is a very interesting score called as SCORE. They have divided into two groups. One is asymptomatic patients, other is symptomatic patients. In the asymptomatic patients, if you see, the mortality is calculated in a 10-year range, not in yearly range. If you see in the first graph, the lower one is the low to moderate risk or high risk. Even if the patient, in an asymptomatic patient, if the risk is still high, the risk of mortality over a 10-year period is around 5 to 9%. So it's not a very significant mortality. Over a 10-year period, the mortality in a high-risk patient who's asymptomatic is 5 to 9%. So in the same way, in the symptomatic patient, definitely the mortality will be more. This is calculated in a yearly basis. So yearly mortality in a high-risk patient will be 3% if the patient is symptomatic. So in an asymptomatic patient, low risk, probably we should think twice before intervening in these patients. Symptomatic patient, probably we should think differently. But an asymptomatic patient, we should really assess whether he needs a intervention or not. That's what the score suggests. Optimal medical management is the key for reducing symptoms. This is what the guidelines tell us. The two objectives, as I told you, is symptom relief and improvement of prognosis. Revascularization obviously has to be done only if the patient continues to be symptomatic, even on optimal medical management. There are multiple meta-analyses before the major trials, which have shown a no benefit or at least a modest benefit in terms of survival, if you compare medical management with the invasive strategy. There are definitely a specific subset of patients where there is significant left main disease, LV dysfunction, or multiple risk factors where definitely intervention is needed. We are not debating that. So CARAES trial is a landmark trial. All of us know it. So published around 10, 12 years back. So again, PCA versus medical management, follow-up of 4.5 years. The primary and secondary outcomes did not differ in CARAES trial. But there were a few criticisms of CARAES trial. One of the criticisms was the stents used were not the best in class. The stents used possibly were bare metal stent mostly, or early drug-eluting stents. POBA was also done. Again, a lot of crossover of 33% was there. So an Orbita trial is again a recent trial. The advantage with Orbita trial was they used a sham control. So one side was a PCA versus with medical management. Other was a sham procedure. So they did a sham procedure with medical treatment. So for 6 weeks, the problem is it was a short trial. 6 weeks. The crossover was only 4%. Primary endpoint was exercise time. The exercise time did not differ in both these subsets. The medical management versus the PCA group, there was no difference in the quality of life or the exercise time. So Orbita, obviously, this highlights a very specific thing that ideally, if you want to do a good trial, you should use a sham control, which most of us or most of the trials don't do it. But ideally, the ideal trial should have a sham control. Again, because Orbita cannot be guideline changing because of the small size, 230 patients and a short observation time. Again, this is a very interesting trial called CONFIRM trial. So this is, they have done a CT angio in nearly 5,000 patients over a 10-year period. So in these, again, subset of patients, they have divided based on the CT angio lesions into revascularization versus medical therapy. So over intermediate follow-up, there was no significant benefit if the patient has got low-risk CAD. in revascular radiation versus medical treatment in the confirm. Nearly 5,000 patients they have studied, mostly CT angio was done, followed by a angiogram, followed by PCI versus medical management. If the patient has got high risk, definitely there is a survival benefit. If the patient is in low risk group, there is no survival benefit. So this is in the high risk group, definitely clear cut survival benefit is there. In the low risk group, irrespective of the age, sex or the risk factors, there was no survival benefit. Coming to the ischemia trial, so what did they study? In stable angina patients with at least moderate ischemia and stress test, is there a benefit of adding a cardiac catheter radiation, if feasible, revascularization? That's the question they did. So this is a, so they have studied stable patients, good LV function, but ischemia was moderate to severe ischemia. Most of them, at least 70% were moderate to severe ischemia patients. 80% underwent CT angiogram in these patients. So with CT angiogram, they ruled out 2-3 things. If the significant left main was there, they ruled out. If there was mild CAD, they ruled out. Then they randomized into invasive group or a conservative medical management group. So primary endpoint was cardiovascular death, MI hospitalization, heart failure. Secondary endpoints were quality of life and time to cardiovascular death. See, what is interesting, I would want you to concentrate on the exclusion criteria. So the NYHA class 3 or 4 symptoms were excluded. Patients with unacceptable angina in the beginning were excluded. Patients with significant LV dysfunction, EF of 35% were excluded. Recent ACS patients, last 2 months were excluded. Recent PCA or CABG in last 1 year was excluded. If the patient had a CKD, they did a ischemia CKD trial. So they did not put in the main ischemia trial. So LV dysfunction patients, significant angina patients, patients with recent ACS or patients with the recent stenting or CABG within the last 1 year. So we're not talking about that group. So rest of the group were taken into criteria. They did 70% of these patients underwent one of the stress tests and 30% underwent a treadmill test. So initially started with 8,000 patient enrollment. There was insignificant ischemia in 3,000, insignificant ischemia or no major block or unprotected left main in 3,000. So finally they randomized 5,000 patients, 2,500 into invasive group, 2,500 into conservative group. So diabetics were around 40%, females were around 25% or 23%, everyone had a good LV function. So stress imaging was in 75% and treadmill test was done in 25%. So if you see, most of them had a significant ischemia in the stress test. So only around 10 to 12% had mild ischemia, but most of them had a moderate to significant ischemia. So around 75% of these patients in the invasive group underwent a PCI, 25% underwent a CABG. Of the 20% of these patients with no revascularization, 2/3 had no significant disease or 1/3 had extensive disease. So basically, so to say that among the invasive group, 20% did not undergo the procedure because 20% were on medical management, either because of insignificant disease or either because of too much disease. So primary outcome did not differ in the both the groups, invasive, non-invasive group, 15.5 versus 13.8. The major secondary events, cardiovascular death or myocardial infarction, again did not differ. If you see, there is a little crossover at the 2 year point, I will just come to it. The net clinical benefit of cardiovascular death, MI, unstable angina, again did not differ. The cardiovascular death again was the same. So this is a 5,000 subset of patients. All cause death, myocardial infarction, I will go to it. So procedural MI was initially high with invasive group in the first 6 months. And the last 1 or 2 years, the spontaneous MIs were more in the conservative group. So initially, procedural MIs were more in the first 1 or 2 years particularly. The spontaneous MI were more in the conservative group in the later part. Again, resuscitated cardiac arrest, hospitalization for unstable angina, stroke, they were all same. So the all the primary endpoints, secondary endpoints were same, irrespective of the groups. So there was no heterogeneity based on the age, sex, or the risk factor group, irrespective of the stress testing, irrespective of the prior data, both the primary and secondary endpoints remained the same. So there were certain limitations. There was no sham procedure. So obviously they excluded certain subgroups, ACS within the last 2 months, highly symptomatic patients, left main stenosis, patients with LV dysfunction. So the females were a little less, so we're not sure whether we can generalize this to that. Again, completeness of revascularization has not been assessed in this. So in the summary of the ischemia trial, the curves crossed for the primary endpoint at the 2 years. So initially, 2 in 100 were having higher estimated rate of the invasive group. Later part, 2 in 100 were having lower estimated rate of MACE in the invasive group. So at the end of 4 years, both were nearly same. Procedural MIs were increased, spontaneous MIs were reduced with an invasive strategy. But what is interesting was virtually there was very low all-cause mortality in both the groups over the 4 years period. So generally they were having moderate to severe ischemia otherwise also, but over the four-year period, the all-cause mortality was very less in both the groups, irrespective of PCA or no PCA. So in the ischemia trial was the highest, was the largest trial of invasive versus conservative. The primary endpoint was not significantly different, neither the secondary endpoint. The probability of at least 10% benefit of invasive on all-cause mortality was less than 10% based on the statistical analysis. So what are the take-home points? Ideally, guideline-directed medical management should be initiated in all patients with ischemic heart disease who are stable. Evidence is strong, obviously, for particularly for low or moderate risk of CAD. In a specific subset of patients, which includes LV dysfunction and left main disease, definitely PCI is preferable. Ischemia gives a very good evidence of OMT versus PCI, specifically in this area of DES, particularly for low risk patients. So let's take ischemia with courage. Thank you.